turned off. Thanksgiving. And he demonstrated one of the important things that we tried to remember in our Sunday school class when that time came, and that was that we shouldn't worry about what am I going to do when I grow up. We shouldn't worry about what is my profession going to be. Am I going to be a doctor or your farmer or whatever? We should worry about, instead, what kind of person am I going to be? I get about 3,000 letters every month. And I get about 150 or 200 that my staff run those out and they send them down to me to read and maybe to write an answer. And a lot of them are from young people. And I always dread it when they said, I am 9 years old and I am 19 years old and I'm in college. I know they're going to ask me a whole bunch of questions I have to answer. But one of the most common questions of what is would be what? What kind of advice do you have for someone who wants to be president someday? Things like that. Well, we all plan our careers, right? In some way. We decide sometime in our life of what we're going to do. If you're a nurse, if you're a woman, you might not be a nurse or a doctor or whatever. The majority of students are not starting to be lawyers or women. Or you might say, I want to be a housewife, I want to be a good mother, and so forth. Or if you're a husband, you want to be different things. But what Zechariah tried to tell us was that we don't need to worry about what profession I'm going to have, but what kind of person am I going to be? And that's a question that can still be answered by those of us in this room, no matter what our ages are. What kind of person am I? And how can I be a better person? It doesn't matter what your profession is, right? In the eyes of God, God doesn't care whether we're a doctor, a lawyer, or a farmer. So as we try to measure up to the expectation or approval of God and other human beings as well, what kind of person am I? Or what kind of person can I be? And if you look at yourself with courage and say, I'm not as good a person as I wanted to be, then the next question is, what can I do about it? And it's never too late to analyze your own life and say, how can I be a person that would be approved by God? And the best guide to that is to emulate a copy of the life of the perfect life of Jesus Christ. Well, today we're going to study about a song that's sung by Cindy. Jan and I both mentioned the angel song last Sunday about the joy and peace. Those two characteristics are human beings. But Simeon, does anybody know who Simeon was? Okay. All right, and where was the temple located? In Jerusalem. And Jerusalem is only, Jesus was born in Bethlehem, and Bethlehem is only 6 miles from Jerusalem. I go there, I've been back and forth often. It's surprising how close Bethlehem is to Jerusalem. So when the seventh day of Jesus' life arrived, and Mary and Joseph wanted to have that baby circumcised and dedicated to God, they took them to Simeon. And as the woman has said, the lady has said, Simeon was an old man, a very devout man, and for some interesting reason, he was also filled with the Holy Spirit. Let's read a few verses from Luke 2, 25 to 35. I'll read them fairly rapidly. Now there was a man in Jerusalem whose name was Simeon. This man was righteous and devout, looking forward to the consolation of Israel. and the Holy Spirit rested on him. It had been revealed to him by the Holy Spirit that he would not see death before he had seen the Lord's Messiah. Guided by the Spirit, Simeon came into the temple, and when the parents brought in the child Jesus to do for him what was customary under the law, Simeon took him in his arms and praised God, saying, this is his song, Master, now you are dismissing your servant in peace, according to your word. For my eyes have seen your salvation, which you have prepared in the presence of all people, a light of revelation to the Gentiles, and for glory to your people in Israel. And the child's father and mother were amazed at what was being said about him. Well, the point that we should remember about Simeon was that he was patient in his faith. He had, nobody knew when the Messiah was coming, except God, through the Holy Spirit, had promised Simeon, you will not die until you see the Messiah. And here, when the baby Jesus was brought to him, 6 miles from Bethlehem, to be dedicated to God, Simeon realized that he had seen the fulfillment of the prophecy through the Holy Spirit. And the lesson that we talk today about Simeon is that we ourselves have an opportunity to pray to God Almighty and to expect our prayers to be answered. This is a privilege or right that God gives us along with life and freedom. Is the right to have access directly to our Creator. And this gives us a powerful, lifelong, permanent privilege. Because at any time in our life, no matter what circumstances are, where we are, anything else, we can connect ourselves to a partner who knows everything and can do anything. If we acknowledge God's presence, His authority, and turn to God. I don't have any memory of a constant prayer I've had all my life, because my prayers have changed as I've grown older and older. But I would say that the greatest prayer that all of us could have in our life, you can disagree if you want to, is the same one that Simeon had, was to know the promised Messiah. And every one of us, if that has been a prayer, it should have been a prayer, we have knowledge of the promised Messiah. He was the Son of God, who is God Himself. And that is the prayer that was answered on Christmas morning. It's kind of hard for me to contemplate or to encompass in my mind everything that was brought to human beings on that first Christmas morning. Because I don't have any direct knowledge of how bad things were beforehand. But there were some dramatic changes made among all human beings when Christ was born. First of all, God Almighty, who created everything, the stars, the heavens, all of us, and so on, decided to come and live among human beings and to share with you and me and the people that lived 2,000 years ago the joys and happiness and and expectations and fulfillment in life, and the sorrows and disappointments and tears of human beings. So God himself, in the form of Jesus, came and lived among us and learned and taught at the same time the proper relationship between you and God and you and your fellow human beings. We've already mentioned one of the transforming characteristics of Christ's coming in one of the previous songs, and that was that all human beings can serve God equally regardless of what your status in life might be as measured by human beings. Regardless of your age or intelligence or education or wealth or anything like that, all of us have an opportunity to serve God and be approved in our life by God. Also, that was the original concept of the fact that all human beings in the eyes of God are what else? Are equal. That had never been the case before. And when Thomas Jefferson added that to the Constitution, all, he said, men are created equal, that is a derivation from the transforming message that God gave us with the birth of Jesus Christ. God also made it clear to human beings that each one of us is worthy. Because in Genesis it says that we are created in the image of what? Image of God. And God reconfirmed that fact that all people, my life and your life, is important to God. So not only are we important to God individually, even when we're by ourselves, alone or forsaken, God looks upon us as a very important person, equal to anybody else. You see how transforming this was compared to what the heathens thought earlier. And Jesus came to demonstrate with his own life what were the important things for us to seek in our own lives or in our own character. And those things are peace and humility, servant, and justice and service to others, compassion for those who are in trouble or in need or in want, and to demonstrate the true meaning of love in its unselfish form. So you see, Christ came and set standards for us to be. Now, Christianity has resulted in a lot of things that have been adopted as ideals for the world. I was in the Navy during and after the Second War. And I remember sitting on the deck of a battleship in the Atlantic Ocean when I learned about the formation of the United Nations. And the reason for the formation of the United Nations, which encompass all the active but important nations on earth, was that there was a pledge for something that the Prince of Peace would want. What is that? Peace. Peace on earth. So Christianity brought a focus of importance to the word peace and justice. And then a few months after that came the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, which was headed by on the American side by Eleanor Roosevelt, the widow of Franklin Roosevelt. And this is just 30 paragraphs. I would urge you to call it up on Google or something and just read it over. It's the most perfect secular summary of the teachings of all the great religions: Christianity, Islam, Judaism, and so forth. And it expresses the highest possible ideal that human beings could imagine at that time. So to establish peace on earth and all of the human rights has been derived from the influence of Christianity. And I'd urge you just to read those over. We fall far short of all of those now. But if we could have, if I could have a prayer, I would say, God, please let us have peace on earth and the implementation of all the human rights promised back in 1948 when it was. And that is what we mean when we say, thy kingdom come on earth as it is in heaven. God's kingdom is a kingdom of peace and justice and equality and service and love. And so who's responsible for bringing that into reality? I would say Christians are, and others as well. So Christians have done a lot, but we can do a lot more. And of course, the one thing I haven't mentioned is that God sent Christ on earth to orchestrate and to demonstrate the fact that every one of us, sinners, can be completely forgiven as though we had never sinned. Because Christ, who is perfect, is eager to accept the sins that we have committed, as though he committed them. And through that process of believing what I've just said is true, we can have eternal life, salvation from God, reconciliation with God, forgiveness for all our sins, and be in effect in God's eyes, as we accept Christ as our Savior, a perfect person. So you see, the Christmas story is complicated in many ways, because it encompasses all of the dreams and ambitions and prayers of human beings. And the answer is in that little tiny baby that was born in Bethlehem a little more than 2,000 years ago. It's an important story, right? But you see, it puts a responsibility on every one of us, right? That's why it's important. Before we're grateful for this wonderful story and the way it was presented to us this year with the songs that were sung in anticipation of and following the birth of Christ. Let all of our hearts be open to receive this message, and let us strive in our own individual way with complete freedom to copy or emulate the life of Jesus Christ. In so doing, giving ourselves access to joy and happiness and peace in our own life. And in the process, we can help establish your kingdom on earth, which you promised us will come someday. Bind our hearts together in Christian love. Forgive our sins. Let us be filled with the true meaning of Christmas always through the year. We ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, thank you for coming this morning. I forgot to look at my notes sometimes. I had some notes. Thank you very much. We'll be having still drizzling rain when we came in, so we'll be having photographs in here. Rose and I will sit down because my doctor told me I need to sit down when I have instead of standing in one place for a long time. When I walk back and forth, I'm okay. If I stand still one time, my legs come. Anyway, we hope you'll all come forward for a photograph. If you want one, it's voluntary. And we don't have to do it. But that's not what you pay to get in. But anyway, and if you have came in a family or in a group, let us have all the family come forward instead of individual. like to come up here by yourself. I won't say anything, but I wonder why you don't have any credit. Thank you. We'll see you.
Pretty good teacher. Amazing. This morning in your bulletin, you found a half sheet of paper that tells you how you can get a copy of today's lesson. We asked you to leave it today by folding it up like a business letter with your cash or check in it and put it into a little black box. That's you. Or if you're not prepared today, just back to the school. When you make the copy, you can make all of the